Three Lives, Three Worlds, 10 Miles of Peach Blossoms by Tangqi Gongzi. Translated by Hamster 428. Chapter 21. I return to King Kaiyu and prepare several more outfits. Then I immediately dash over to Jian's Shi Li Tao Hua to shamelessly ask for some extra medicine. I've only gone halfway when I see Jian heading toward me on a cloud. Behind him is fourth brother on Bafang. They break right in front of me. Fourth brother says with twinkles in his eyes, "Little fifth, your long time wish is coming true today. We've just returned from Zihai. Dai Yong was twisting the entire night yesterday. This morning Jian used the soul-seeking art to examine him and detected that Moi Wan's soul is no longer in Dai Yong's consciousness. We're about to head over to Yanhua Cave. Moi Wan is probably picking this auspicious day to wake up after 70,000 years of sleep." I stand there bemused momentarily. When I finally regain my thoughts, I see myself pulling on fourth brother's hand while stammering these words, "Teacher has woken up. He's awake now." Fourth brother nods his head then furrows his brow, "Hey, your bag's fallen off the cloud." I knew within 3 months Moi Wan would surely wake up. However, it's only been 2 months since Dai Yong took the pill. How did he wake up in such a short time? Is he really awake? Jian lowers his head and sighs, "Yehua's sacrifice isn't a waste after all." My eyes burn with tears as I nod in reply. Fourth brother laughs, "I heard about Yehua from Jian. What a lovesick guy. But you seem to be rather unlucky with your fate. You've only just repaid your debt to Moi Wan and now you owe Yehua in return. You used your blood to repay Moi Wan for 70,000 years, but what will you use to repay Yehua's 40,000 years of life energy?" I cover my eyes which are beginning to sting with my fan and reply, "Yehua and I will become husband and wife eventually. There's no favors or debts in love between spouses." From the middle of a cloud, Jian laughs, "You finally figured it out. Because I was a male disciple when I studied under Moi Wan, I want to disguise myself back into Xian." Jian holds out his hand to stop me. "With Moi Wan's ability, he already knew you were a girl since a long time ago. He didn't uncover your identity for the sake of your parents' face. Did you think you had deceived him for 20,000 years? I draw my fan back and laugh, "You're right. Mother's magic could deceive my 16 seniors, but I was a little skeptical that it could deceive teacher. The three of us are coming closer to Mount Fang II. I take the lead and lower the cloud down. China roses bloom along the mountainside, their fragrance spreads across the entire mountain. It is now autumn in August. I go straight into Yanhua Cave. Within the drifting fog at the end of the cave is the bed Moi Wan has slept on all these years. My sight is getting blurry in this important moment. I quickly wipe my eyes, my hands wet from doing so. A hazy silhouette of someone sitting appears on the bed. I hurriedly walk over. The one leaning on the bed is undoubtedly my teacher Moi Wan, who has been in years of deep sleep. He is looking at the flower vase placed next to him. His face, his expression, they're exactly as they were 70,000 years ago. My tears fall down uncontrollably. The noise I make calls to his attention. He turns around and props his face on his hand. He smiles at me peacefully, "Little 17th? Right. It is little 17th. Come over here and let me take a look. Let's see how much you've improved over the years." I dig my fingernails into my flesh and hear my heart drums within my chest. I come over with quivering steps. I call teacher out to him and in a flash, millions of conflicting emotions entangle around each other. He reaches out to support me and says, "Why do you look like you're about to cry? This outfit on you isn't bad." Jian comes through the fog as fourth brother follows behind. He says, "You've slept for 70,000 years. You only got up now." I sneeze from the cold within Yanhua Cave. Fourth brother drags me out as Jian and Moiwan unhurriedly follow us out. We return to the fox cave. After he fell into his slumber, most of my seniors have returned home. Only ninth senior Ling Yu stays to take care of Kunlun, so the atmosphere there is much less lively now. I'm not sure how to tell teacher this if he were to ask. But surprisingly, the first thing he asks about wasn't Kunlun. While we have tea, teacher asks Jian, "Have you seen a young child who looks exactly like me while I was asleep?" The teapot in my hand spills onto fourth brother's knee. Fourth brother suppresses his pain and grins to me while wiping off the hot liquid. Jian laughs and glances at me, "There certainly is. Furthermore, he's in a relationship with your little disciple over there." Moiwan turns his head to look at me. My face starts to flush while Jian winks repeatedly at me. Before his eyes go into a cramp, I quickly say, "This person you're talking about, haha, he's probably my fiancé, the crown prince of heaven, ha ha ha." Moiwan's cup-holding hand instantly freezes. He takes another sip to clear his throat. At length, with an unchanging expression, he says, "He has good taste, that guy." Then he looks up and says, "What is your fiancé's name? When was he born?" I answer him truthfully. He calculates on his fingers and says, "Little 17th, you've somehow lured and entrapped my younger brother." I feel like I was struck by lightning as I shout, "What?" I wasn't the only one stunned. Even the more knowledgeable Jian and fourth brother are dropping their jaws. Moiwan turns the teacup in his hands and says, "I can't blame everyone for being surprised. I too only knew of this when my father passed away. It turns out my mother only gave birth to me, but there was indeed another brother." Moiwan says he probably needs to tell the story from the moment his mother conceived the two brothers. Once upon a time, the four columns holding up the sky broke down. The nine continents started to crumble. Because Mother Deity, Mushan, had to repair the columns, she ended up affecting her pregnancy. When she came into labor, she could only save the first, but not the second. Father Deity, Fushan, felt he had wronged the little baby, so he tried to retain the baby's soul within his own. He used up half of his life energy to create a womb for it. But no matter what he tried, the baby wouldn't wake up. Fushan then turned the womb into a radiant egg and hid it behind Mt. Kunlun to wait for the baby's soul to return. Unfortunately, both Mushan and Fushan passed away together before their child could wake up. Before Fushan died, he told this story to Moiwan and asked him to take care of the baby's soul after separating it from his own. Moiwan took his brother's soul and sustained it in his own like Fushan did. The world collapsed and collapsed again. Yet Moiwan's brother still couldn't wake up. Moiwan tells us, "He finally woke up when I used my soul as a sacrifice for the Donghuang Bell. I'm awake now all thanks to his effort in collecting my scattered soul pieces. I have a hazy memory of a little child gathering my soul next to me. At the 70,000 years mark after he has gathered about half, there came a golden light flying across our cavern, sweeping him away. After he left, I had to collect the pieces by myself. It was difficult, and the pace greatly slowed down. You say that he's now the crown prince of the Heaven Clan. Then I'm guessing that the Heaven Family's madam must have swallowed the hidden egg when she passed by Mt. Kunlun. The fetus probably pulled him away when it was born from her womb. Jian slightly chuckles and says, "No wonder they said when the brat Yehua was born, there were 72 rainbow birds dancing for 81 straight days and auspicious light shining from the east for 3 years. Turns out he's your younger brother." Zhu Kongdian's historical records clearly say Fuxian's only son is Mo Yuan. Now I know these historians are barely trustworthy. It's better to believe those fates scripted by the idol Siming. Mo Yuan wants to meet Yehua, but since he's just waken, he needs a few years of rest to restore his energy first. I give him some quick excuse and promise to take him to Yehua once he has recovered. Teacher insists on going back to the cave behind Mt. Kunlun to carry out his meditation. Although I don't want him to see the desolation Kunlun has fallen into, I won't be able to hide that fact away from him forever. I thought we'd only get to see Ling Yu today. But the moment we step into the entrance, the scene before our eyes make us jump in surprise. My 16 seniors don their Taoist robes according to rankings, their hair bun up in the Taoist style, as they stand in two lines by the stone door. The big tree inside is still the Shaolixuang tree gifted by the Buddhas from the west. My 16 seniors ceremoniously stand under the canopy as if they've stood there for all 70,000 years. Eldest senior leads the pack as he kneels on the ground with red eyes and trembly says, "Ninth brother sent a letter several days ago telling us dragon energy is amassing over the Kunlun sky. Once in a while there is even the sound of dragon roars. He doesn't know what it means, so we hastily came back. Although the possibility of your return crossed our minds, we daren't believe it. Today while inside, we felt your energy from beyond the mountain entrance. We immediately came out, but we're late to welcoming you at the gate. You're finally back after being gone for 70,000 years." He breaks down in sobs as he finishes his words. He looks young, but he's in fact quite old. Everyone wells up as well seeing him like this. The other 15 seniors also drop down in silent sobs. 16th senior Zilan cried most miserably. Mo Yuan's eyes darken. "I've made you all waited for too long. Stand up and let's go inside." First my seniors all cried for a while. Then they say they've lost useless ole me, see in Chen Jun. Eldest senior seems so afflicted when the story comes to me. I was the one who drugged them and stole Mo Yuan's body out of Kunlun, but he doesn't mention any of my wrongdoings. Instead he only says it's his fault for not taking care of me and losing me. He's searched for me non-stop all these years, but there's never any news. He's afraid my fate is grim. He feels he hadn't done his responsibility as the eldest to take care of his juniors and asks for punishment from our teacher. I stand leaning against fourth brother next to them. Without thinking, I blurt out, "What grim fate, I'm still happily alive. I've only changed the way I dress. I'm Xian." They all go into shock. After falling to the floor, eldest senior gets up and hugs me, "Ninth brother said you also went through a homo nightmare. That year when the second prince of the demon clan came to deceive you, I thought I've beaten that dream out of him. But who would know that I haven't stopped yours? My poor 17th, so you've turned gay, the cross-dressing kind no less. Fourth brother can't stop himself from laughing out loud. I endure those heartbroken tears and say, eldest senior, take a good look at my face. How am I a cross-dressing male? Tenth brother pushes my stammering eldest senior over and says, this is why you wouldn't bathe with us. Turns out 17th is a girl. Fourth brother drawls his words out, she's a beauty, full, whoa, man, I give him a kick. Eldest senior has never been this way. He's really gotten sentimental over the years. After I left, every one of my seniors has made a career for himself in these 70,000 years. These 16 seniors of mine weren't particularly brilliant when we were young. I followed them around and learned all the tomfooleries in the book. I can't forget to credit my 16 seniors for the way I turned out. However, they made me like this, yet all of them are successful now. When heaven scripted their fates, he must have dozed off all the while. But I'm thankful that heaven dozed off just so. Teacher is probably thankful too. After talking for a while, when my ears are full of information about their outstanding careers, I feel somewhat down. I compare myself to them and depression starts to wash over me. Fourth brother stands nearby with a brush to document things. Once in a while he'd clap his hands and shout, remarkable. Remarkable. This feeling of sadness makes me somewhat disappointed. Tenth senior consoles me, bro, sis, you're a lady, haha, a beautiful lady. A beautiful lady doesn't need to have a successful career. All of our sisters only think about marrying a good husband. You should find a good family to marry into too and life will be fine. 16th senior grins and says, at 17th, we shouldn't talk about marrying. I'm afraid she already has a few young ones. Right. When will you bring your husband here to meet us? With your looks and personality, I wonder what kind of man you married. His words are stabbing right at my sore spot. I wipe the sweats on my forehead and awkwardly laugh, you're exaggerating, I'm not there yet. My wedding's next month. You guys have to come and drink with me. Moi Wan sits pensively beside us. At the word drink, the teacup from his hand splashes as half of the tea spills out. I hastily run to him to wipe the liquid. Jian lightly coughs twice. There's nothing extraordinary about the fairies who come to visit. Sometimes eldest senior or second senior would take them to see Moi Wan for a bit. Sometimes they'd only get to sip a bit of tea in the main hall before leaving. Only the young man who comes at noon on the third day has a bit of a problem. This young man wears a white robe. He looks quite elegant and mild. When Moi Wan sees him, his normally icy face becomes affected. The white-robed man gets to see Moi Wan but he doesn't proceed with the greetings. He only looks into the distant and says, it's been a long time, you still look the same. Zhong Gaian has only come to Kunlun this time because my older sister appeared in my dream last night asking me to pass on some words to you. He smiles and continues, my sister says she's all by herself, and she's so lonely. I call the attendant who serves 7th senior over and ask him to bring this Zhong Gaian guy another cup of tea. Moi Wan remains silent, with his sickly cheek propped on his hand. Jian glances over to Mui Wan, then turns and says to Hong Guyan, "Brothers Hong Guyan, surely you are joking. Your older sister has passed away for 100,000 years already. How could she come see you in your dream?" Hong Guyan widens his eyes in anger and says, "Master Jian, you've misunderstood me. I really came here to pass on my sister's words. There are no hidden meanings. I didn't even want to waste my time to begin with. But my sister had looked so pitiful in my dream, so I couldn't bear to be heartless. You say she can't come to my dream because she's turned into dusts. But isn't it also true that Master Mui Wan, who's sitting here, has also turned into dusts? If he can come back now, then what's wrong with my sister visiting me in my dream?" He bows low after his last word and exits the main hall by himself. Mui Wan leaves his seat and walks back to the inner hall. I spring up to follow him, but Jian stops me. "I had a feeling that my teacher Mui Wan has a lot of history long ago. Everything was right, he's really also someone with a past." From Zhong Guyan's few words, it seems like in the Year of Time there has been a period of awful history. I'm a little worried. I want to come see Mui Wan after the guests have left and give him some consolation. At night when I come by Mui Wan's room, he is already sitting pensively in front of his zither. The yellow candlelight highlights a sad look on his face. I stand still by the door. His eyes suddenly left the zither and glance up. He slightly smiles and says, "What are you standing there for? Come in." I quietly come in. I came wanting to comfort him, but now all words are stuck in my throat. I don't know much about his story either. I only guess it was a love story from what the white-robed man said. But how should one start when she wants to comfort someone about a sad love memory? I was still in thoughts when the sound of the zither rings by my ears. Mui Wan's fingers pass over the strings and he says, "Your bad habit of daydreaming still hasn't changed after all these years." I scratch my nose and grin. Then I come over to his side and say with concern, "Teacher, dead people can't come back. Zhong Guyan probably only missed his sister too much. Don't keep it in your heart." He twitches, then continues to strike the zither and casually says, "You came here tonight because of this." I nod my head. The zither rings chaotic sounds from under his fingers. He looks up at me. After watching my face for a long while, he asks me a completely unrelated question, "Are your feelings for him true?" I think for half a day before I realize him means Yehua. I feel awkward talking about this in front of an elder, but I'm not the type to be shy and embarrassed either. So I scratch my nose and honestly answer him, "It's true. As true as can be." He lifts his head and looks out to the window. At length he says, "Then that's good. I don't have to worry now. I don't really understand." His expression is strange today. Perhaps he's worried that I'm not feminine enough to be married into a good family? Thinking so, I happily assure him, "Teacher, you don't have to worry. Yehua's a good person. We get along very well. I truly love him as he does me." He keeps his head turned and casually says, "It's getting late. Go back to your room and rest." After that day, Mui Wan doesn't come out to the main hall anymore. That night I walked across half the building to comfort him. But by the time I left his room, I discovered I haven't comforted him at all. I feel kind of bad. Maybe only he himself understands the issue. Outsiders shouldn't interfere to begin with. We thought without being able to see Mo Yuan, the people who come to visit would lessen. Who knew they are still so excited? After 12 days of disguising as a tea servant in the main hall, I can't stand it any longer. I pull forth brother to the apple tree and ask him to change places with me for the time of 7 or 8 incense sticks so that I may come down to the mortal realm and see Yehua once. Fourth brother counts on his fingers and says, if I watch for 7 or 8 incense sticks, then I surely can't sleep tonight. I'll help you for 1 stick at most. Yehua's only in the mortal realm for 1 lifetime. It's not even that serious and already you want to sneak a peek? You sure fell fast for him. My face remains constant except for my burning red ears. I didn't pick the right time to act today. I totally forgot that he had a fight with Jian this afternoon by the veranda. But 1 incense stick is still enough to satisfy me. I immediately dash out to the front yard. He throws the 2 apples in his hand into the lotus pond nearby as he nonchalantly says, if you don't return within the time of 1 incense stick, don't be mad when I come down to drag you back myself. It seems fourth brother is really angry at Jian today. The starry river on Kunlun twinkles in the pitch black night. On earth, it's daytime with miles of stretching blue sky. I stand outside of a private school in invisible form. The sound of reading voice rings out, the uncle met Han Zhuangzi. Zhuangzi was concerned with his livelihood, so his uncle brings him gifts. My eyes follow the voice and see a handsome child in the last row. This child is more beautiful than the rest of the mortals, although not as handsome as Yehua. But his cold aura is exactly like Yehua's. The reading stops. The lecturer looks to the book in his hand and says, Zhao Ji, why don't you stand up and explain this passage to the class? The icy-faced child stands up. My heart slightly trembles. He really is the reincarnation of Yehua. I know no matter what form he takes, I will always be able to recognize him. I stay invisible outside the bars of the window and wait until their class ends. The 2 servants help Yehua clear the things on his desk and walk him to the door. I quietly follow behind, not knowing how to appear before him naturally. As I ponder my options, 2 sounds of rushing air whiz by from behind. I wave my sleeve by reflex and the 2 small flying pebbles immediately change direction, hitting the trunk of an ancient tree by the road. The noise makes Yehua turn around. The 4 children shout and run away. As they run, they sing a 7-line rhyme. It goes as follow. Rice is precious, oil is prized. The Liu family gave birth to a disabled child. Sinned in the past, ordinary in this life. No one pities him, as it's eye for an eye. A prodigy be he might. But how far shall a handicapped fly? I was struck dumb. I gaze over to Yehua's right hand. Damn that bastard Tianjun. Yehua is his grandson. How can he be so heartlessly evil? He didn't even give Yehua a complete body during reincarnation. There's only the sleeve where Yehua's right hand is. It's clearly, clearly completely empty. Yehua's young attendants chase after the other kids before they are called back. I can still remember those kids are Yehua's schoolmates. As an experienced person, I naturally know what they're feeling. They're obviously jealous of Yehua's extraordinary talents. But couldn't they have stayed silent in their jealousy? How malicious of them to come up with such a rhyme. Yehua's left hand holds down his fluttering right sleeve as he slightly furrows his brow. He turns ahead without saying anything. Having seen everything, my heart aches. I can't show myself because I'm afraid they would see me. I can only swallow back my tears. I follow them from dawn to dusk and still can't find the right time to show myself to Yehua. His two annoying attendants are always with him. By the hour of the dog, they help him undress for bed. After half a teacup time, they also yawn their way to bed. I sigh in relief and appear by his bedside. After watching his face in the moonlight, I slightly shake him up. He turns and sits up half awake, half sleeping. What's going on? When he sees that I'm not one of his attendants, he becomes startled. He looks at me for some moments before closing his eyes and falling back to sleep. He mumbles, "So I was dreaming." I quickly wake him up again. Before he can open his mouth, I block him and ask, "Do you know me?" I knew he won't, but I hope nonetheless. As I thought, he replies, "No, I don't." Then he knits his brow as his sleep leaves him. "This isn't a dream." I take a light pearl from my sleeve. Following the light, I bring my hand to his face. "Do you think it's a dream?" His small face slowly colors red. How can Yehua become so shy after reincarnation? I inch closer to him. After each time I inch over, his face would turn a deeper shade of red. I've never seen this strange appearance from Yehua before. I sit right before his face as he backs away to the wall corner. His round face is flushing red, but he tries to appear calm. "Who are you? Why did you enter my bed chamber?" "In the past, I read a novel that tells the story of a white snake falling in love with a young man named Muyu. She fell ill from lovesick and came to find him at night. Seeing Yehua, I suddenly want to tease him. So I hide my face in sadness and say, 'I'm a fairy from King Kaiu. I come down to the mortal realm for a spring stroll and fell in love with your appearance. My heart constantly misses you and now I've fallen ill from lovesick.' At the end I pretend to be embarrassed while glancing at him. These words make me shiver in goosebumps, but from his facial expression, I think I've acted quite well. He is lost in confusion. Then his face colors a flushing red. He covers his mouth and clears his throat. "However, I'm only 11 years old compared to you. Before parting, we give each other promise gifts. I give him the same bracelet he gave me when I descended to the mortal realm to help you and Zheng. I can't be with him at all times, so if he wears this bracelet, my worry will lessen." He takes off the jade pendant on his neck and wears it on me. I lower myself to his ear and remind him, "You absolutely can't marry any other woman. I'll come visit you when I have time. I'll wait for you. When you mature, I'll become your wife." He blushes and nods his head in all seriousness. End of chapter 21.